Hello and welcome. My name is Chad Oman, and today I'm showing you how to build one of these. This is a CO2 monitor, but by and large, it's an atmospheric monitor. Monitors CO2 in your air, the concentration, as well as voltaic organic compounds. It also measures your temperature, humidity, pressure in your given space. It's not 28 degrees in here, but it's because I'm holding it that it's this high. But it also gives you an at-a-glance as to how your air is in your space as it pertains to the CO2. So this LED is an RGB red, green, and blue LED. It's set up that it will change to yellow when the CO2 is higher than 1,000 parts per million, and then it'll turn red when it's above 1,400 parts per million. That is all customizable in the MicroPython that's running in this device, and I'll show you what's running inside here in a moment. The goal of this project was inspired through mitigating COVID-19 risk in a given space. Now, we know that COVID-19 is airborne. As a result, you know, we know that humans expel CO2 when we breathe, and when we're breathing and we're infectious with COVID-19, we're also breathing out the virus. When the CO2 is higher in a space, it can be a proxy to know whether or not, you know, you're in a situation where you could be, you know, more likely to be exposed to COVID-19 or to an infectious dose of COVID-19. This in no way is a medical device at all. but the great thing about this is that it definitely gives you some peace of mind, or it helps you determine that, oh, I need to make some changes in my space. Well, I brought this down to my family, my parents' house for Christmas. And I put this out, and at the time it was set up on a breadboard here, and it was actually very fascinating to watch. We were in the kitchen, and the kitchen, living room, and dining room is all an open space, and slowly the CO2 built up in that area. Eventually, this LED turned yellow, and then it turned red, and we knew that, okay, well, we've got a little bit of a problem here. We tried turning on the ceiling fan, and really that was just circulating the same air in the space. But as soon as we turned on the furnace fan, this dropped very quickly, and effectively helped us manage our risk. And thankfully, you know, we didn't have any problems or any unwelcome visitors for Christmas, which was great. So this guy here is, it's in a 3D printed case. The design is also available for you to print out if you have a 3D printer. And it fits all the components really nice and easily here. So it's just micro USB, and this power bank, and this have been, it's a 4,000 milliamp hour battery bank. It's been running for 3 days, and I'm down to 1 bar. So it actually does last a really long time. The front is press fit onto the back of the case, and inside we've got the OLED or organic LED display, super low power, as you know, and in between here I've got some hot glue to keep that in, but also we've got this these DuPont wires that connect from the OLED to a custom PCB. And on this custom PCB, make sure I'm focused here. On this custom PCB, I have two breakout boards from SparkFun, and you can find these chips elsewhere. I'll show you a couple examples of that here in a moment. But in terms of what I decided to use, it was turnkey and accessible to everyone, and I thought that was really important. Here, I'll zoom in just a little bit on this. There we are. So in terms of this, we have the CCS811, which is a carbon dioxide and total voltaic compound sensor. It's actually reversed, but that's okay. I'll show you what it looks like here in a moment when it's not soldered onto the board. And it's measuring, now this is a MOX sensor, a metal oxide sensor. And what that is it's a little tiny piece of metal. It gets heated up to, you know, 500 degrees or so. And then the resistance is measured across that. And when there's a lot of CO2 in the space, The resistance changes, and that's what it's measuring, is based on the resistance of that little piece of metal that's being heated up in here. There is another type of sensor that I'll go over here in just a moment, and why I decided to choose this sensor as opposed to the other one. So stay tuned with me on that one. In between here, I've got the leads for the OLED. And then on the bottom, we've got the BME280, which is a temperature, humidity, and pressure sensor. Oops, let's get back into frame here. that's it for in terms of what we're using to measure. The LED is also here and soldered onto the board. And on the flip side, this is a Raspberry Pi Pico. It is not a Raspberry Pi that you would normally use. This guy here is actually just a microprocessor. It's not a full-fledged computer. And it will run MicroPython, which is exactly what I wanted for this project. It just gets flashed onto the chip, and that's all it does. So it's super low power. It's a it costs $4 US to get one of these. In terms of the other chips, really the whole package, including the custom-made PCB, really ran me about, I don't know, $40. And that's way cheaper than, say, a $200 CO2 monitor from a commercial option. And this is the case here, just taken apart. It's got a slot here just for the board, so that just slots in there once it's complete, like that. And then to reassemble, let's get this back in frame. So there you see it inside there. To reassemble, all we're doing is lining up, and I'm doing this through the camera, so bear with me. Lining up that LED with the hole, and it just snaps back together. We'll plug it in, and it comes on. So initially the LED is blue, it's gonna say initializing. And once it's done initializing, then it starts to read. Now, if you haven't used a sensor for a while, that metal oxide piece of metal in there on the CCS811 chip does cool down, and it cools down really quickly. It doesn't have a lot of thermal mass. So sometimes you'll find that this blue light will stay on for quite a while, and that's because it does need to heat up, and that takes about 20 minutes. Realistically, if you plug this in anytime, the first 20 minutes of readings are really preliminary readings, and I wouldn't use them as 100%. Like right now it's showing 400, where when I unplugged it, it was up in the 500 range. And really the sensitivity of these chips is really plus or minus 50, 75 parts per million anyway. And the goal of this project isn't to scientifically measure CO2 in a space. It's really to figure out, is there a higher risk of contracting COVID-19 in a space? And do we need to adjust ventilation? Or do we need to add a HEPA filter, like the Corsi Rosenthal boxes? So that's the chip. That's it. That's all it does. That's it. It's super simple and super cheap to build. I'm really happy with it. This is just version one. Okay, let's get into more of the components. This is the custom printed circuit board or PCB. And it's really quite simple. You've got all the leads for the Raspberry Pi along the outsides. You've got a space for the CCS811 here. You got your leads for the display. And then you've got a spot for the BME280 and then your RGB LED. The RGB LED does have to be a common cathode LED. And that means that it shares a common, negative. I believe I could be wrong. It could be the other way around and share a common positive, but I don't have my specs up in front of me. And then on the back, you've got all the silk screening for the Pi, and that's it. So the schematics and everything for this board is also open source, available on my website, chatoman.ca. And you can order it from, JLC PCB or PCBWay, whichever you prefer. I found that JLC PCB was much cheaper. And that's the board. Now, in terms of the display, these are the OLEDs. Now, all of your components need to be I2C compatible, meaning that you've got power, ground. You've also got this clock pin as well as the data pin. Super simple, super lightweight. I think I got 5 of these for 20 bucks. I can't remember, but these I found on Amazon. And they actually came with pins as well if you do need them. And that's that. This is the BME 280. I'll just open this up here from SparkFun. Tiny little chip. It has the BME 280 package on it, as well as a couple of resistors to tell it to talk either in I2C or in, I think that's serial on the other side. What we only care about is these 4 pins, and that's what we'll be using here later. And then we have the CCS811. And this is, again, a SparkFun option. And you can see the CCS811 package in the middle, and then some resistors there in the middle. My lighting is not very great. You'll have to bear with me. And then you've got your pins, and we only care about the ground, the three volt, the I2C pins, as well as the wake pin. And the wake pin has to be pulled down to ground for it to wake up. And on the side here, we've got some pads for a temperature thermistor, but this actually isn't the best way to do it, and that's why we opted to use the BME 280 instead, and then using some math make that work. I also found these chips as well on Amazon. You can get them in packages, I think, of 3. This is the BME 280. It's the same chip, just different. And this is the CCS811 that I found. It does have the pin soldered on already. And you have to be really careful, because you'll notice, yes, on this one, if you look really closely at what's marked there, the positive is actually the first pin, if I turn this the right way, as opposed to the ground. And if we look at the SparkFun one, the ground is actually the first pin. So there's 2 versions of the PCB that I've created, one with the ground on top here and one with the positive on top. So it's really important that you make sure you use the right board, otherwise you're gonna smoke your chip. So that's that. And then the Raspberry Pi Pico comes in a cassette like this, because they could actually be used in pick and place. So I ordered 3, so they gave me 3 off the strip. And this is it. And it doesn't come with the header pins, so you do need to source your own header pins, but depending on where you get it from, they may also, you know, give you the option of ordering header pins for that. And in terms of what we need to solder, I'm only gonna bother soldering the pins that we use, as well as the grounds. So that's that. Now, another thing we're gonna need is some DuPont wires, and I just got these off Amazon. We'll zoom out just a little bit so you can see these. These DuPont wires go for super cheap. You can get them in the female male, the male male, the female female, and they just come in a package of a bunch of them. So what we need is we need 4, and I do already have 4 that are kicking around here, so I'm going to use those instead for this build. But that's what you would need. And if you do need header pins, again, Amazon, super cheap. You can get them in bulk, and you just break off what you need and go with that. So that's that. Now, the other kind of sensor that we could have used for this project, and I might use in version 2 depending on, and you need your LED. So this other sensor that you need, or that you might want to, you might consider, is the NDIR sensor. And it, the only company that I could find it where the package was completely on a breakout board is the sensor on one. And this is the SCD30. What it is it's actually emitting, it has a infrared LED in there, and it's actually measuring how much light gets passed, because CO2 is gonna absorb a certain wavelength, and that's the wavelength that this LED is producing. So if it isn't getting the full amount of sunlight here, or sorry, if it's not getting the full amount of infrared light that this LED is emitting onto the sensor, then it's measuring some CO2, and it would adjust its measurements in that way. These chips are like $60 Canadian, $65 Canadian. I cannot find these anywhere in Canada. I had to import this one. It does communicate over I2C. So I mean, it's worth experimenting with. I don't know if there's a MicroPython package for this guy yet. These are slightly more accurate, and these are the chips that you'll find in like the Arrinet and the other commercially available options is these guys. But again, $60 versus $40 for the whole kit and caboodle here, right? Like, we're not here measuring scientifically or clinically how much CO2 is in a space. What we're concerned about here is how much, or what is our risk in this, in this space? And, you know, this is really great if you need to measure it down to, you know, 50 or 25 parts per million. Again, that's not what we're after here with this project. We're just wanting to make sure that, do we have enough ventilation in this space or do we not? And that's what this is going to go after here. So that is the NDIR sensor. Again, super hard to find, probably because they're all being used commercially. So that's that. The other thing we're going to need is a soldering iron. So here's mine. I have mine set to 320 degrees Fahrenheit, or Celsius, sorry, which is 607 degrees Fahrenheit. And I'm just using some unleaded solder. And I think it's really important that I could use, you know, lead solder, but, you know, it creates more fumes, and then you got lead in your board. With GLC PCB, I did opt for a lead-free board. I think that it's really important that if we were to put these in schools or other environments that we aren't introducing lead as a compound. We're also measuring total organic voltaic compounds as well. And to me, I would think that that would skew our measurements. So that's why I opted to go lead free. So that's that. Now to get started on the build, we're gonna need to put some header pins on this first. And the important thing here is do not populate this board with anything more than your LED before you put any of the chips on, because you're gonna have to solder these header pins on first. And if you solder, you know, if you get your header pins on for the CCS811, you put your board on here, it's gonna cover up those pins and make it really hard for you to solder underneath. I've done it, but it sucks. Similarly, if we do put on the BME280, it does make it a little trickier again. So just do your pins first and then put your chips on afterwards. Is gonna make it a heck of a lot easier. If you do get this particular style here, you could go ahead and populate with this. Again, it's gonna poke straight up, and that may not pose a problem actually with this particular case, but your mileage may vary. What I would suggest really is to desolder these header pins and put your own pins on that aren't bent. Again, that's more work. And what we're after here is a turnkey solution that's, you know, something that schools could build as a project. So that may not be an option. So the first thing we're gonna do is I'm gonna get some header pins. I think I'll need two of these, not three, but anyways, I've got three now. Okay. These are your header pins. You'll notice that one side has longer pins than the other. What that means is that you're gonna have the longer pins go through the board. If you haven't assembled a PCB before, this is, you wanna put those pins through, and that, because that way you have approximate amount, the same amount of pin on either side of the board. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna count, and I like to just line it up against the board, maybe put the first pins in here since we've got a lot of pads, and put my finger right where I need to cut it. And I'm gonna use a pair of snips. And actually my finger just moved, so we're gonna try that again. Okay, right there. And move my thumb, put the snips in. I mean, you could count. And make sure you hold both sides, because I find that these really like to like fly away like it just did. So then you can put your pins in, and now you've got approximately about the same on either side. Now, if we put it in this way for the Raspberry Pi, you're going to come in, you're going to run into problems because that Pi needs to sit on the other side. So in this case, you're going to have to be really careful and watch that you put your Raspberry Pi pins with the plastic runner on the side that the Pi is going to sit on. So in this case, when we line it up, maybe, there we go. Now you've got this plastic insulator between, let me see if I turn this again. You've got this plastic insulator between the PCB and the Raspberry Pi. And that's what we're after, is just a little bit of air gap to separate these two boards from each other. So we've got the first one, and we're gonna go ahead and break off the second one, and I might speed up the camera here. Maybe not. We'll decide in post. And again, holding both sides, and then again, making sure that we line it up again, make sure we didn't miscount. And nope, we've got enough pins there. That's great. So now we've got our Raspberry Pi pins, and now we need four for the BME280. And I can just eyeball that and say there's four. Okay. And now we're gonna need, what is it, five for this particular board. Now, again, going back to this other solution here, this Amazon version, if we look it's hard to tell because I still have the package, but the RST and the wake pin is actually swapped. And on this one, you'll find, and if I flip this over, that the RST pin is the last pin on this chip, on this this board, and the wake pin is the, fifth pin from ground. So it's really important that we pay attention to that. If you are sourcing your own chips, just make sure that you're looking at the board and comparing to, so that you don't go through all this work of soldering all this together and then find out, oh crap, the pins were not correct. You know, this is a problem, right? It's not gonna work. So we need five of these. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep. And it's easier to cut from the other side, actually. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We get our snips in there. And cut. Okay. And that is it. That's all you need for your header pins. You can go ahead and put the excess back in your bag in case you have another project down the road you want to use these with. Sometimes the boards do come with header pins with them, so that's also really handy, but by and large, I've found they don't. And then we need our DuPont wires, which I've got two here and two here that we'll use. And that is all we need at this point. So the first, what I would want to suggest is first do your LED. And on the board, it's really hard to see these little tiny pads, but the first thing we're going to want to populate is this LED. And on this, I don't know if it's going to be easy to see. Yeah, there we go. You'll notice that the leads off the LED are different lengths. The longest length is going to be your cathode, your common cathode. So we're going to go ahead, and that common cathode actually traces back, if we were to look at the back of the board, it traces back to ground. So we know that this third pin, or the second pin, sorry, looking at the other side of the board, is what we want to be our cathode. So we're going to go ahead and carefully line up into these tiny, tiny little holes. Okay, oh, we got it in, then we got it out. And I think I bent the pin, because I'm shaky. Make sure, yeah, it's really hard to see. Okay, so now it's in partially. And yeah, I did bend that pin, didn't I? Oh well, that's okay. So what we wanna do is we just wanna have just enough lead on the back of the board as possible. And then I'm gonna fold this LED down. So now we've got this folded down, and this is where it's gonna poke out the front. And I'm not being too scientific with the measurements here. I find that if your leads are a little bit too long, when you push everything together, it just kind of crunches together, which is fine. And from here, we're gonna go ahead and solder this. One thing that's really handy is to have a vise. This is a 3D printed vise that I made a long time ago. It's a little bit broken, but it works really well for projects like this that I need something lightweight that I just need to throw on my desk, and this works really well. I think you can find this on Thingiverse, and really, really easy little thing. Took a long time to print, but it was a good print. So I'm gonna go ahead, because we wanna make sure that LED sits nice. I'm gonna do this directly on the surf on my table. And there we go. So we're gonna take our iron, and I've got a really fine tip on here, and I'm soldering through the camera, so you're gonna have to bear with me here. But what we wanna do is we just wanna heat up that first pad right there, and then flow some solder onto it. I think we've almost got it. Yeah, there we go. And then we'll move on to the next one. I'm looking too far away from this. It's really hard to see here. Try to flow some solder on this. Come on, you. Yeah, I can't see anything. Let's see. We'll go from this angle here and see if we can get it. It's still in frame now. Let's see. Oh, there we go. Okay. And then do the third pin. There we go. And the fourth pin. Okay. And I made a total mess of that because these pins are too small. Who designed this board? So we're going to clean that up and be right back. Okay, so now we've got the LED cleaned up. One good thing to have handy is some solder wick. It is really handy. You just push this up against your bad joint, and it'll suck up the solder that you messed up with. So that's really handy. Okay, so now what we want to do is we want to get our header pins on for the two sensor chips. So we're going to flip it over where we've got text, and we're going to push in one of these. So this is the BME280. It doesn't matter which one you do in which order. But it is good to get this one done first. One pro tip is actually if you take a breadboard and press it into, you know, the middle or something, you can get this lined up pretty nice. So it's level. I just find that I just hold it and it's okay, but that is an option, and I can use this to prop this up on this side. So it's level. Let's do that in frame. There we go. So now we're just going to solder these joints, these pads. And I don't claim to be a big soldering expert. So if you're sitting there screaming like, oh my God, this guy's horrible. Yeah, you're probably right. Okay, those are done. What I would have to say is one of my favorite smells is solder. So there we go. We've got two joints done, two points done. I don't know why I keep calling them joints. So now we'll get the last header in here that we need to do on this side of the board. Now you'll notice that one of these pads is going to be unpopulated. I do have this board accommodated, so if you did have an RST pin, and those are swapped, this board would still work with it. The only difference is you wouldn't solder this fifth pin, you would solder the sixth one instead. And that's, and really you could just, pinch off six of your header pins, and then pull out with some tweezers or pull out one of these pins so you don't even make any electrical contact by accident with ground at all. That would be my recommendation. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and do this again. And solder this. Am I in frame? Yeah, I am. Okay. And you want to be quick when you're soldering. If you're new to soldering, you want to be in and out. because you don't want to heat up any of your components too much, because you could actually end up causing damage. And that's actually a really important point with both of these sensor chips, is that they do have a rated max temperature. And if you exceed them, you're going to throw out the accuracy of these boards. So it's really important that you are in and out. And that's that. So we'll just go ahead and inspect these pads, make sure we've got enough solder on them. And actually, I'm not really happy with that ground pad, the square pad at the end. So I'm going to go ahead and add a little more because we've got a little bit of a gap there. Okay, that is that. So now what we're going to do is we're going to populate the pi side, going through my 26th puberty here. And we're going to remember to put the insulating headers on the opposite side of the board, just like this. So now you've got these header pins on this side, and you got the other header pins on the other side. So that's a little hunky-dory. I'm going to go ahead and solder these. You've seen me solder enough. We're just going to set this on the breadboard so it stays nice and secure. You can maybe push it in just a little bit if you need to. Probably is not wise to push it in all the way, but I'm going to go ahead and solder these and be right back. Okay, we are back and all the pins are soldered. It's really important. I was thinking about this when I was going through. You want to make sure that you're in and out as quickly as possible, but not too quickly. You want to make sure that your soldering iron is directly on the pad, and you'll see that pad slightly change its reflection, and then you know you're good to go, and just hold it there while the solder flows on, and that works really well. So now this is done. The next thing we want to do is we want to crop the pins on the Pi side, because we don't want any of these pins to touch the Raspberry Pi. And this is something that I would highly recommend that you get some eye protection for, because it can get a little bit dicey. Because it's really tough to see where that pin goes. And I'm sure that when we move at some point, I'm gonna find a bunch of these pins everywhere, or they're gonna end up in my socks. You could maybe do this into a sandwich bag too. That might actually be the best course of action, but in this case, for the purposes of filming, I'm just doing it like this. And yeah, I hear it hitting the other side of the room. I hit two walls. Okay, and then we just have the LED pins, and these actually you could do first before you solder on any pins. And these are actually a lot softer, so they don't go everywhere. Okay, so those are all cropped. That's great. So now we've got a nice board we can mount our Raspberry Pi to, as well as our other chips. The last thing that we need to solder directly onto the board is your DuPont wires. With your DuPont wires, what you want to do is you're going to want to stick them through the hole, just like that. And I like to line them up so that you've got the same side. And if you're using particular colors, which some people are, then using the black for ground or what have you might be easier. Again, just remember what color is what. And actually, when you're peeling off your DuPont wires off of the main, because they come kind of all together, nice thing to do is to peel off four all at once and then you've only got to do this one, do the soldering and aligning and everything once. So in this case, it can be a little tricky to do. So we'll get rid of that. And actually, I'm going to stick in my other two wires here to make it just a little bit easier on myself. Just like that. Okay, so they're all in. And then I kind of have them at an angle, but you want to make sure you have them at the right angle. So the right angle to do this is actually towards the top of the board if you have one of the Spark Fun boards. Let's see here, make sure I'm saying that right. Yep, it is. So then we just kind of set it down gently, kind of as they're pinched like that. The LED doesn't make it any easier, so we'll just have to hold it really gently, maybe tilt it onto its side just a little bit, and we will solder on those points. All right, that is done. Those look really nice, beautiful. We're gonna crop those as well. Just make sure that everything's nice and lined up here. Nothing comes out. You'll wanna give it just a little bit of a wiggle to make sure you've got a good solder, and then crop these off. That hit the camera. Okay. There's that, and we've got these, which are gonna go to our display. Super awesome. So now, what I would recommend doing next is the Raspberry Pi. Now, if you're confused as to which way this goes, I decided to leave on the debugging serial pins on the very bottom here, and you can actually, they're not, I wouldn't solder these at all, just leave them as they are. They're just there as a marker for you. That way you know that you'd line that up with your Raspberry Pi. If I get this on, and it can be tricky getting all of these pins lined up, because it looks like, yeah, I've got a little bit of an angle on these ones. So we're gonna go ahead, and you wanna make sure that the bottom of the board goes with the top of this board. Okay, oh, there it goes again. I should have lined these up a little better. Maybe. You might need to apply just a little bit of pressure. Or we need to bend these pins. One or the other. It's really important that you line up your header pins, because see, now you've got an issue where these pins are at an extreme angle, and this is going to be tough to fix. So bear with me. I'm going to be right back. This is something you don't want to do. It looks worse in the camera than it actually is. Let's be real here. We'll get this fixed up. Okay, now welcome back. We've got this figured out. What I used is just a pair of pliers. And just carefully bent the pins ever so slightly. That worked great. And now we're back to it. So in terms of the Raspberry Pi, we are only going to use the pins. Let's get this lined up here. We're only going to use the pins that, I'm only going to solder the pins that we use. And I'm actually going to take a look at my PCB on the computer to remember which ones we need. Okay. So the ones we need are, can't pull it towards myself. Zoom in just, there we go, that's as far as we can go. The ones that we need are the ground and the 3-volt, as well as the last pins. Here we go, ground and 3-volt here. And then we need the last two pins, GPIO 16 and 17. And then we also need the ground on this side, as well as GPIO 2, 3, and 4. So GPIO 2, 3, and 4, those are for the LED. And depending on what color you want, it will power one or more of those GPIO pins, provide 3 volts to those to change the color or to light up VRGB. These pads are a little bit larger, and I do have a very fine tip, fine tip soldering iron here. I could change out that, but that would mean I'd have to let it cool down and heat it back up and all that stuff, and I just really don't feel like doing that. You'll notice that on your Raspberry Pi Pico that the ground pins actually are square, so that's the same thing as on the custom board. Just so that you know from a glance which ones are which, and you can locate what you're looking for. These do take a significant longer time to heat up, particularly with this tiny little, soldering point. So that's good. You want to make sure your soldering iron doesn't touch this boot select switch. So you'll want to angle it a little more than you're probably used to, just to get in there, and we'll flow some solder on that one. Give it a second to saturate. All right, and then we'll go on to this one. That one looks good. And our final pin, GPIO4. A little more, my finger's running out of space. There we go. So that's about good. You're not going to get the whole pad. I mean, you could spend the time and do that, but we don't really need it. And then on the other side, we're going to go ahead and solder the ground pin on this side. There's actually more than one ground pin. We're only using the two on the custom PCB, so that's all that I'm too worried about. And we'll flow onto that one. And that one looks good. And then I'll have to inspect this closer afterwards because I can't get close enough to really see what I'm doing. Your view is actually better than my view, so I might have to add a little bit more solder to these depending on. And then the last two pins on this side, GPIO 17 and 16. Yeah, that looks good. We'll get a little more on there. You want to give it just a little bit of a bead, but nothing too much, so that the solder flows into the hole and also touches. So that gives it a little bit of structural strength, and I think that looks pretty good there. And we'll give it a quick inspection here and make sure things look good. Looks like I could add a little more solder to that 3-volt pin. Otherwise, and actually GPIO4, it looks pretty sparse. So we're gonna add a little bit more there. So to reheat, just get your solder iron nice and close. You'll see that it pulls it in. We'll add a little, oh, there we go. That looks good. And then we'll do this 3-volt here. And just being very careful not to touch that other component. Yeah, that looks much better. You see how it kind of pulls it in as things heat up. That looks really good. And you don't want to spend too long with your soldering iron on that pad because it's going to heat up this board, and you don't want to heat it up too much and then end up messing up something else. So you want to be quick in and out, kind of like I was doing there. Okay. Now, we want to go to the other side. So I'm going to take this out and we're going to flip it over and get this back in here. And snug in there, maybe. Okay, these are cropped. So now we can put our CCS811 chip on there, lining up the ground with the ground. And this is where you might need to bend the display DuPont cables back just a little bit. And then we'll put that on just like that. And that sits really nicely, making sure that all my pins aren't conflicting here. There's something pushing on this side. Oh, we have one more pin to get rid of. So we'll crop that last pin. There we go. Get this back on here. There we go. And yep, perfect. That sits on there very nice. And now we can solder these on. Make sure I'm still in view here. And again, because these chips do have a maximum heat tolerance, you want to be in and out really nice and quick once you get that pad nice and warm. Sometimes using a little bit more heat on your soldering iron, if you've got one that adjusts temperature, like mine does, you can get it a little hotter, but just bear in mind you've got, you know, that much less time to get this on. So a good spot is about 320 degrees Celsius. Okay, that board is on. We can go over to the other side here. And this one, we don't want it at an angle, of course. So we're gonna have to put something underneath it to prop it up. And the best thing I've got is another set of DuPont wires. I think we can just kind of tuck underneath one, just like that. Actually, that is perfect. And then we'll go ahead and solder these four pins, and then that is the end of our soldering. And once you get one on, then that should do it. You can pull your DuPont out or whatever you're using to prop up. I mean, really, you could just hold it with your finger, but I like to use a tool if I can. Improvise, if you would. There we go. The ground. And that looks good. Looks like a little more on the clock pin here. There we go. And it just makes this nice little tent is what you're going for. This really nice little tent. Okay. I sound like Bob Ross, but for soldering. All right, so we're not going to use header pins on the OLED, which is our next and final thing to do, is we're just going to use these DuPonts. If you were using male to female DuPonts, you could use the header pins. This is the only solution that we're going to be using this board for, so I'm not too concerned about having these soldered on directly. Again, you want to make sure things are lined up. So you could have soldered this on first so you could see what the silk screening says underneath. That would have been the best case scenario. And for me, I'm just going to go ahead and take a look at the schematic for the board to make sure that I'm aligned. And we're going to want to make sure that the ground, which is the farthest one away, is first. We're just lining them up. Ground. And then the data is the third pin, which I think we have is blue. There we go. So now we've got these lined up. You could power on the board as well and use a multimeter, but ultimately what would be the easiest is to solder the OLED wires together first, and then you don't have to remember which one's which here. So ground, yep, that's good. Data, you want to check your OLED to make sure that you've got the pins right. So in this case, clock is actually our third pin, so we're going to swap these two back because they were right the first time. So blue is going to go on the outside. Yep. Okay. So now from the bottom to top, we've got ground, 3-volt power positive. We've got clock and then data, which is SDA, SCL, SCL, SDA respectively. And we're going to come at this. Oh, and looks like we've actually got positive on the outside too. So we're going to swap our ground and our positive here, negative and positive. Okay. That looks pretty good to me. And we're gonna put these in from the back. And just kind of line them up. And this is easier when you've got them all together. Okay, those are those two. And then these two, get those in there nice and snug. Okay. And then get them all pressed in there nice. I'm probably off camera, I'm not actually, okay. There we go. And then you wanna just double, triple check. So our white is our positive, yes. And on the board, yes. Our ground is our black, yes, on the board, and yes, on the PCB. Clock is green, yes, and yes. And okay, so we are good to go. And to solder these, it's kind of tough, but I just kind of bend the wires just a little bit here. And you might have to hold it just ever so slightly. Get your solder in here. Get this on camera. And then just, kind of get this figured out. There we go. Awesome. We'll just inspect our job here. And it looks pretty darn good. We're just gonna bend these backs. They're straight, they're gonna be hot, so just be careful. And actually it looks like we have one pin that wasn't all the way in. So we're gonna go ahead and apply a little bit of pressure, however you can. Remember, this soldering iron is really hot. So we're gonna apply a little pressure, and then we're gonna reflow that solder. And there we go, push that in. It'll cool off real quick and everything is secure. That is the end of our soldering. That is it. That is the complete board. Let's zoom out just a little bit now. That is the complete board. Holy smokes, great job if you were following along. And we're gonna go ahead and plug this into the computer with a USB cable, and we're gonna flash the board, and we will be right back. All right, welcome back. So here we are in front of what's called Thonny, which is a Python IDE, specifically for MicroPython. And it's lightweight, it's open source, and you can download it I'll link it in the blog, so you'll find it there. And the first thing that we want to do is we want to plug in the Pi. So I've got it here. This is what we built earlier. So we're going to go ahead and plug that in. And okay, we are good to go. You're not going to see any lights or anything on the Raspberry Pi itself. But the one thing that you're going to find is initially it's going to say, couldn't find the device automatically, check the connection, that's all good. Down in the bottom right, we've got this MicroPython Raspberry Pi Pico. We're going to go ahead and click on that and then click on the checkbox. And this is going to say, hey, do you want to install the firmware? I'm going to say, yeah, we do need to do that. So what we want to do is we want to click on install. And it's going to copy over the MicroPython firmware and the latest version of it. Okay, so we're good to go. So now we've got a MicroPython shell here, and it looks like everything's working good. So the first thing that we're going to want to do is we're going to want to go to open, and we're going to go to Raspberry Pi Pico, and that's going to open up the file system on the Pico. And we're not going to actually open anything right now, but what we're going to do is we're going to create a new directory, and we're going to call it lib. And I'm going to hit cancel. That'll close that window. We're going to go back to open, which is the file folder up at the top. Click on this computer, and we're going to navigate to where you have downloaded the GitHub repository. And in this case, we're going to open up a few things. Let's see I've never tried this. No, you can only open up one at a time. So we're going to open up the BME280.py. We're going to open up the CCS811.py. We're going to open up the SSD1306.py. We're going to open up the main.py. And we're going to leave it there for now. You don't have to do anything with...
the first three, all we need to do is actually save it onto the Raspberry Pi Pico. So the way that we're going to do that, you could either do Control Shift S, which is save as, or we can go up here and we're going to go save as here. And in this case, where do we want to save to? We want to save it to the Raspberry Pi Pico. And this is where that lib folder comes in. So we'll double click on that. It's going to bring us in. And what do we want to name it? Just BME280.py. So this is the library for Python, the Python library for interfacing with the BME280. Once you save something to the Pico, it's going to show with these brackets to tell you that it's actually on the Pico. Again, we're going to do this with the CCS811. So we're going to say save it to the Pico, and we're going to name it CCS811.py. And it's important that you do put in the extension. Otherwise, it just saves it as exactly what it's going to save it as exactly what you tell it to. Again, saved. And then we're going to go back in here, save as to the Pico. And this will be the SSD 1306 library, which is the OLED library. And there we go. So that's saved. Now, word of caution. You could, in theory, save the main.py to the Pico right now. The challenge is that when you unplug it and you plug it back in, the only thing that's going to happen is that it's going to run main.py. It's very difficult to get an interrupt into that, and you're just going to end up having to reflash the Pi. And the only way you really get about doing that is holding the boot cell button, the boot select button on the Pico, the one that I was careful not to touch with the soldering iron earlier, and that way it renames the main.py so you can get back into it. So we can do that. I can show you how to do that. Or we can just not do that until you're ready to go. And you've got everything set. Okay, so in the code here, in the main.py, I'm not going to go into too much detail other than here on line 44 and line 48, we have these address lines and these address variables. It's important that these address variables correspond with the particular chip that you're using. In this case, if you're using the SparkFun BME280 and the CCS811, these are the addresses that it'll be presenting as for the Pico. And the way that you can figure that out is I have added another full file, what's called my I2C test.py. I did upload that to the GitHub, so you do have a copy of it. And it's very, very simple. It's just saying turn on the I2C protocol and then scan. So we're going to go ahead and run this. And when you run it, it's just going to run that. Okay, perfect. So this is actually a really good test to make sure that your Pico is working, that you've got communication with the three different chips that are involved here. So in this case, we have three different devices that it's talking to over the I2C bus, that being 60, or in hex, it's 0x3C, 91, which is 0x5B, and 119, which in hex is 0x77. So we can go back here and we can clearly tell, okay, good. And actually I was going to say something's wrong, so we're going to carry on. BME280, obviously, we've got a 0x77, so we're good there. If I've also seen the BME280s come as 0x76, so that's important to note. And then in terms of the CCS811s, I have seen them 5A, so just bear in mind that, is that if you do get a 5A, it's most likely it's CCS811 as opposed to your BME280. If for some reason you don't change these addresses, it's just not going to run. You're going to get an error. It's I think an IO error 4, and that's just kind of it. So if I were to say change this to a C and then run our main.py, yeah, there we go. So you're going to get an error here. It says here that something to do with the library, but actually it's actually your line 48 here, which is your first error that shows up here. CCS811 not found. Please check wiring. Make sure that you pull the wake to ground. See that this library is actually really great for that. And if we were to say change this to 78, run this. Yep, see this library doesn't exactly handle that error very well, but it does give you an error number 5. So just a heads up on that. So if we do run this now, so it's not run, it's running on the Pico, but it's only being fed over the console. So it takes a second to initialize. But what do you know? We now have an LED that's going green. And let's take a look at the display. Holy smokes, look at that. There we go. It's as easy as that. One thing to note with some of the BME 280s that I've found on Amazon, not all of them are going to give you a humidity reading. And I'm not sure why that is. That's not going to really focus, is it? Oh, there we go. It's not going to give a humidity rating, and I'm not quite sure if it's something to do with my with the library or if it's something to do with the actual chip. That may come down as an update later on. But for now, this is how that works. And with the SparkFun boards, it works just fine. So that's really great. And that's it. It's running on. Well, it's not running on its own because we're getting the output to the shell. And remember that I had mentioned earlier that with the CCS811, the MOX sensor, the readings take about 20 minutes to warm up. And in the case of a brand new CCS811, it takes about 2 days for it to calibrate itself, basically. So the readings in the first 2 days are not going to be accurate at all. I've compared this to, well, let's do this. I have another, my other one that I was showing earlier, and we're getting 455 parts per million on the one I'm holding in my hand. The one on the desk is showing 414, but I've seen them out of whack by over 1,000 parts per million, just sitting across the desk with a brand new one, and the one that's been burnt in, as if you will. So just like a brand new gasoline engine that you might need to burn, work in, it's the same thing with this. And actually, yeah, I don't know if this is going to come through on the microphone, but there's a slight squeal, and that's coming from the CCS811. That does get quieter over time as well, so it's kind of an indicator that, you know, okay, if you can't hear it, then that's good. But you're always going to hear, without a case on these, you're going to hear a slight squeal off these chips anyway. But if I was to blow on this, yeah, there we go. It just went red, yellow, and it dropped down again. Again, the readings aren't going to be 100% until, you know, the 2 days is up, the 48 hours. Another important thing to note here is that if you look at the pressure, it's 938 pascals, or what is that, kilopascals, not exactly 100%. That is measured at sea level. Me here in Edmonton, Alberta, we're what, like 1600 feet above sea level, so it's measuring the pressure based on what it should be calibrated to at sea level. Again, that could come down as an update, or if someone wants to fork the code and actually decide to go in there and put this in as a patch, put in an altimeter of some sort, saying, you know, you put in a variable here that says, okay, what's your altitude, and then it compensates for that. That'd be super cool. Again, wanted to get this out so that, and I mean, really, the goal here isn't to measure pressure. The goal was to measure CO2, so that wasn't on my priority list. But that's the chip. That's the board. And if you've been following along and you were building one yourself, congratulations. This is super rewarding. It is a fun project, and I hope you enjoyed it. Now that we've got it working, we've tested it here, everything seems to be working just fine. The last thing we're going to want to do is hit stop, and that's going to stop the code from running. I found, it just says backend terminated. I found this with the Picos that it does want to disconnect, so all we do is go down here. You could just hit stop, and it'll load back up, but sometimes you have to go down here and choose Raspberry Pi Pico again. So that's all good. Now we want to save the main.py to the Pico. Now remember, when you unplug the Pi after this and you plug it back in, it's going to always run main.py, and that's totally fine. This is what we're expecting. We're going to save it to the root directory, main.py, and click OK. And now that's saved, so that's all good. And that's it. You're done. Now all we need to do is unplug it and plug it back in. And it automatically comes on. It says initializing on our little screen. And in a second, there we go. It starts reading and now it's green and it is doing its thing. And that's as simple as this is. So there we go. Thanks for watching. I hope this helps. If you have any questions at all, definitely reach out. I'll put my email address here at the bottom here. And if you also have any thoughts or suggestions, definitely reach out. I would love to work on a version 2 that has some sort of data logging. I'm probably going to have to go to an ESP32 for that as opposed to a Raspberry Pi Pico. But for literally at a glance, how are we doing? This is exactly what this project's for. And yeah, thanks for watching. I think we're getting a little long in the tooth now. So again, yeah, reach out if you have any questions at all. Thanks so much. Take care and stay safe.